Dan, what am I doing in the hospital?
You took an overdose of pills. Anne and I want you to go to a sanitarium.
I'm not nutty. I am just hooked on dolls.
Not enough.
They say getting off them is worse than booze or dope. I'm scared. I've forgotten how to sleep without dolls. I can't get through a day without a doll. Please, Lylah, don't send me there. I need a doll.
Hello and welcome to TCM Slumberground, the pre-show party for TCM Underground, which airs every Friday night, late night on Turner Classic Movies. My name is Millie DeCherico. I'm the programmer for TCM Underground. As always, I am joined by my esteemed TCM colleagues, Matthew and Ben, and a big hello to our new square, the TCM social media goddess herself, Diana Bosch. For this episode, we are going to discuss two movies that actually have a lot in common. Both were melodramas made at the tail end of the 1960s. Both are concerned with the darker side of show business, and both now have reputations of being these juicy, over-the-top camp masterpieces. We're going to be discussing Valley of the Dolls from 1967, directed by Mark Robson, and The Legend of Lylah Clare from 1968, directed by Robert Aldrich. As always, Matthew, please regale us with a synopsis of Valley of the Dolls.
So Valley of the Dolls was directed by Mark Robson and released in 1967, and it centers on Anne Wells, played by Barbara Parkins, and it follows her journey after college from a small town in New England to her pursuit of a more exciting life in New York City. And along the way, she meets Neely O'Hara, played by Patty Duke, who's starring alongside Helen Lawson, played by Susan Hayward. She also befriends up-and-coming showgirl slash actress Jennifer North, played by Sharon Tate. The film eventually shifts to Hollywood, where they're all pretty much taken over by this sort of glamorous dark side of the city. And the movie is sort of about the trials and tribulations of all three of the women navigating their relationships, their careers, how to make it in the business, addiction, and sort of this jumble of different melodramatic elements. And some of them make it out and some of them do not.
That's for sure. I definitely want to start this conversation out with talking about the book Valley of the Dolls, which of course was written by Jacqueline Suzanne. And I'm curious about how the book was received when it came out and also just how it became a film. Diana, do you want to give us the rundown on all that?
Yeah. So Jacqueline Suzanne, if you ever Google a photo of her, she looks so similar to Barbara Parkins. And she was ahead of her time using media to promote her books instead of reviews. Before she became an author, she won a beauty pageant and tried her hand at acting, but it didn't really work out for her. And what inspired her to write Valley of the Dolls is that when she was 44, she was diagnosed with breast cancer. And that really changed her life. And she was like, I have nothing to lose. How about I write a book? This is how I'm going to make it. And Valley of the Dolls is actually inspired by her journey because she actually tried to commit suicide. And the dolls is basically her nickname for the pills that she tried to take. And to put in perspective of how big this book became, it sold 30 million copies within a year. And she ended up becoming the first author to have three consecutive number one bestsellers. And the book is very salacious. It's a dirty book. It's kind of like A Star Is Born meets Showgirls.
Now tell me about yourself. Where'd you come from?
Different places.
And I think that's a really good way of like thinking about like it being dirty. So 20th Century Fox, which was struggling at the time, actually paid $1.5 million for the film rights. And this was a lavish, top-notch production. You have music by John Williams, title song by Dionne Warwick, and all these up-and-coming stars. And if you watch it, it just really takes you to the delectable Hollywood lore that everyone thinks about when they think of Hollywood.
Yeah, so part of the thrill, I think of watching a movie like Valley of the Dolls is that knowing that it came from this really popular book, I think people were really excited to see the movie version. And certainly everybody that worked on the movie was thinking it was going to be this really big deal. And afterwards, you heard so much about the on-set dramas, about how Mark Robson and Patty Duke fought on set. Also, this being Patty Duke's kind of first grown-up role after being a child star for so long. Ben, I know that you were a really big fan of Patty Duke as a kid. So what do you think of her? What did you think of her when you saw Valley of the Dolls?
I loved it. I mean, because I grew up watching Patty Duke on like reruns as a kid on like TBS and Nick at Night. The Patty Duke show ended in 1966 and this comes out in 67. It was really surprising, but by the time I saw it, I was just like, oh my God, this is great. It's so campy. It's so over the top. The more that you find out about Patty Duke's life, you know, she had a mental breakdown in between doing the Patty Duke show and this and attempted suicide. So it was like coming on to a movie set, reenacting her life.
Well, you know, what's really interesting too, is that when the film came out, I read that Jacqueline Suzanne actually thought it was trashy, which is saying a lot, but also, you know, the critics thought it was kind of just like this crazy over the top monster of a movie, but people loved it.
People loved this movie. Valley of the Dolls was a huge hit. It went on to become number 4 at the box office behind The Graduate, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, and a re-release of Gone with the Wind. So that's pretty big competition when you consider it's 1967 and all that people were trying to see at the movies and, you know, leaving their houses with their TVs to go see this movie.
There's a story there that I think I connect with a little bit more now than I ever did in the past, which is young women going to Hollywood and being kind of broken by it, which I feel like is a tale as old as time. But there's actual moments of real sadness too, where I'm actually like emotional for these characters in a lot of ways.
The Sharon Tate character is so tragic. Even if you separate what you know about her, she's so good in that part of just realizing that like people just think she's a pretty face. And she has that first scene where you see all that promise of her like coming out with the big headpiece and all that regalia. And then to see how she ends up, it just, that really got me this time. And the Barbara Parkins character, I think people can connect to her just like as a metaphor of your 20s. Like there's the scene where she watches Helen Lawson come out and do her performance and you see her and she's just so wide-eyed and being like, I can be that. And it really shows that innocence that when you're starting out in some point of your life and then kind of it just goes off the rails.
Yeah. I mean, it's like anytime she'd have that moment of reflection with the Dionne Warwick song playing, I was like, God, like I'm actually shook by this. Like, and I love how she goes back to her like New England, like all that heaven allows town that she's from. And there's that waterfall and it's like, she's home, she's safe. She doesn't have to deal with the Hollywood bullshit anymore. It's like, man, it's actually pretty emotional for me now. So
I know, like I, every time she was on the screen, I was always like, when will I, how will I, what, when will I know?
Okay, so now we're going to move into our second film, which is The Legend of Lylah Clare. Matthew, please give us a synopsis of this film.
Yeah, so The Legend of Lylah Clare was released in 1968, and it was directed by Robert Aldrich. And it tells the story of an actress named Elsa, played by Kim Novak, who bears an uncanny resemblance to this larger-than-life actress named Lylah Clare, also played by Kim Novak, who had died in an accident under extremely mysterious circumstances years ago by way of an extremely treacherous staircase. From there, it's really about Elsa sort of inhabiting this role of Lylah while also navigating her place in Hollywood, and similarly to Valley of the Dolls, is caught up in all the dark aspects of the film business. And ultimately, in an almost like a persona-like fashion, the line between Elsa and the actress Lylah, who she's studying and portraying, begins to blur with sort of tragic results. And it's really part melodrama, part thriller, part satire, all melded into this cautionary tale about the dangers of Hollywood.
Yes, right off the bat, we gotta talk about the director Robert Aldrich, because I think I would be willing to say we're all big fans here on Slumberground.
Sure.
You know, in his career, he made many films. I mean, he did Kiss Me Deadly, The Dirty Dozen. But I think for us, certainly us here at TCM Slumberground, we know him best as the director of several films that feature classic Hollywood actresses in their mid to late careers or middle age, maybe. Yeah, I think obviously the best known is Whatever Happened to Baby Jane, but he also directed Hush Hush, Sweet Charlotte and The Killing of Sister George. And I have to say my personal favorite, which is Autumn Leaves, starring Joan Crawford. Yeah. These films, I think, would eventually be sort of referred to as Grande Dame Guignol, or more informally, Hacksploitation or Psychobiddy. And so knowing all that, I wondered if anybody had any thoughts about how the legend of Lylah Clare might sort of fit into this tradition.
I think the Elsa character is kind of the young, fresh, unspoiled, reborn version of Lylah. And then the more that she feeds into the trappings of fame, or like feeds into popularity and all those sort of things, the evils of Hollywood, she starts to become possessed. I think that's where the kind of the monster part of the psychobiddy comes into play.
Yeah, and that's, this entire movie is filled with older actresses, like, mm-hmm. and they're all kind of in that, I would say, that kind of grand dame role, especially the Molly Luther character, who's played by Coral Brad. I mean, she's basically like supposed to be like a Hedda Hopper type, right. I was assuming, and like the leg brace scenario and how she's just so shitty to Elsa when she's being introduced to right. like the Hollywood press. And you're just like, to me, I feel like those are moments where it does kind of take the psychobiddy route, where it's basically just like older women who are, you know, really going there. They're it's like an over the top performance, right?
I will say about Kim Novak's acting, I really believe her as the two different people. Like I thought, and unfortunately, I think the dubbing of the Lylah voice just kind of takes yeah. away from it all.
Now get out and don't come into this house again.
To make it really, you know, campy. My dark horse is Ernest Borgnine, because I mean, he is just having so much fun. And right. I love his, I don't make films, I make movies. And I'm like, yeah, like you did Marty and then Ice Station Zebra. Like, I love that. He owns it.
Yeah.
I think my dark horse is Kim Novak walking around in her bra in the garden with a sweater around her neck. Like,
was
I don't
she
have,
cold?
I,
was she?
I don't know what the point of that scene is. Like,
if I look like Kim Novak, I wouldn't wear a shirt.
I mean, it's show off that torso, honey. It looked great.
I wanted to talk a little bit about just sort of like the gothic elements of the movie, because you know, not only is it present in all of these like remarkable paintings of Lylah that are all over this house. The decor on that place is just insane. Like I would be so scared to walk up and down those stairs. I would just back up against the wall and just go up that way.
I mean, I would die immediately just staring at that portrait of Lylah. I would just look at that and just walk off this ledge, you know?
Yeah.
They really needed to get a railing for those stairs, I thought.
So I was like, there's no rails on this thing. Every time they walked up the stairs, I was nervous.
One of the things that I noticed watching both films are the queer elements involved within The Legend of Lylah Clare. There's a bisexual relationship. And in Valley of the Dolls, there are references to queer culture. And I just wanted to know a little bit more about that and the time period and kind of like where it fits when you watch these films, because they do say the F slur. And to me, like, I was just really, you know, rattled by that. But like, I think there's an important context to be discussed with regarding that.
Yeah. I mean, I think that remembering that these movies are coming out in the late 60s, you know, this is pre-Stonewall. So they're mentioning, like, Valley of the Dolls, there is the F-slur, and it's shocking when you hear it, but it also always gets a laugh. You know, I mean, it's like, these are women who are in the theater world, they're in Hollywood, they're around homosexual men, they have friendships with them, they have relationships with them. So, I mean, I think that they use the word in the same company. And like, it is shocking to hear, and I'm sure that some people, when they hear it now, it's, you know, like they're immediately turned off by it. But I think that oftentimes we think as a modern audience is that we're on a joke that audiences at the time weren't. And that to me, it was like a good reminder. It's like, oh yeah, they knew what they were watching and why they were enjoying it.
I think too, there's kind of a safety in the way it's delivered to by women versus it being delivered by men. That feeds all back into the whole notion of camp and just sort of these sort of avatars, right? That these women become for gay men, you know, big figures that you can really attach to that either had these really hard lives or, you know, struggled through a lot. I think that, you know, using words like that, it's like you can only do it if you're a friend or a familiar, and it gives this permission. It's almost permissive in that way. And so that's why it doesn't, I think it gets taken as funny instead of offensive, especially by gay men. And I think that's why it's been sort of absorbed into the culture as such.
You know, part of what I think is interesting about both these movies, and I programmed them together for a reason, because they just obviously seem to have a lot of commonalities. But I also think too, that both of these movies are about very strong female performances. And that is sort of what makes these movies camp, you know, over the top, sort of high key emotional performances by these women who are not shrinking violets. I mean, they're like really powerful and they're saying a lot of crazy stuff and they're acting their asses off. And I feel like if that's anything that unites gay men and women together, it's seeing these performances. I mean, that's why I programmed them for TCM Underground alongside other movies like heavy metal, like, you know, David Lynch, David Cronenberg. Like, I want us to be inclusive and include movies like this as part of the larger cult canon. So, all right. I have a final question for the group. I hope everybody's ready. It's kind of a big one. So if you had to create a title for the high-key melodrama film story of your life, what would it be? And I'm starting with Ben.
I think I would just kind of go off of the like kind of deadbeat uncle genre of like a Uncle Buck and like Rodney Dangerfield type of things. I feel like that's the male equivalent of the psycho bitty. So I would be who let Uncle Ben eat all the cookies? And it's just, I passed out and forgot to watch the kids, and then chaos ensues.
All right, Diana, you're up.
So my inspiration is the revenge thriller trope, going back to, you know, past few years have been pretty tough and we've been on our devices and working a lot more. So to be inspired by a Joan Crawford fave, it would be, I saw what you wrote in the comments. I'll just leave it at that.
I bet. Matthew, what about you?
Okay, so I have a, similar to Ben, I have a baking-themed yes. film title that sort of honors the psycho bitty genre, and it is Pie Pie, My Darling.
Oh my God.
I definitely went the melodrama route, almost moving into like Douglas Sirk territory, but I started thinking about like, what did I spend a lot of my life doing? And it was being at video stores. And so mine is called No Late Fees for Miss Millie. So that is about all the time we have for this episode of TCM Slumberground. Once again, I would like to thank my esteemed TCM colleagues, Ben, Matthew, and Diana. Great job. Thank you so much for being with us. And hey, if you're watching this on the TCM YouTube channel and you want to leave us a nice comment or give us a thumbs up, please do so. Also, if you're on Twitter and you haven't followed us yet, we're at TCM Underground. Thanks everybody for watching. And here's hoping that nobody gets possessed by the legend of Lylah Clare.
Tell him Lila's coming soon as she gets her harness on. Keep your filthy hands off me. You better get down here, fast. You're so much smarter when you don't try to think. You're a masterpiece. That's a joke.